So, Wednesday we must be dead to groups, so today we are going to work with race. So start with this. Suppose we have, we look at 2x2 matrices of abelian numbers, and we are looking at this set K, subset of an offer 2x2 matrices, which is formed by matrices of this type. So on the diagonal we have the same element, on the other two elements are one opposite to each other. So we want to prove that K is a subfield of the ring of matrices. Start with that. Okay? So number one. Now, first of all, what is a subfield? It is just a subring, which in addition is a field. Okay? So we start by proving that A is a subring of 2x2 matrices over the rings. Okay? How do we do that? Well, I'm going to check that it is closed under all the operations. Okay? And so, first of all, we observe that the neutral element for the addition, which is the null matrix, belongs to K. Well, why is that? Because that follows if you take A equals 0, or take A equals B equals 0. Okay? Then, I'm going to check that, so first I'm going to look at the operations, okay? So I'm going to check that the zero, it's closed under zero, opposite and addition. Remember you can replace this by checking that it's closed, that it is non-empty, and that it is closed under differences. As I said, I prefer to do it not for all operations, because that also brings out the algebraic structure, which might be needed for further calculations. So inverses, so suppose matrix A is in K, and then let's compute the opposite. Okay. So then A is A, B, minus B, A, but then this implies that the opposite of A is minus A, minus B, B, minus A. Now let's look, what does it mean to belong to K? Well, it means you can have any elements A and B. The only thing you have to have is the elements on the diagonal must be the same, which is indeed the case here. You see we have minus A and minus A. They are equal. The other two elements, so the one in position 2, 1, must be the opposite of the one in position 1, 2. And indeed, B, which is in position 2, 1, is the opposite of minus B, which is in position 1, 2. Therefore, this matrix is in K. So we just proved that if A is in K, then minus A is in K, that is to say that K is closed under opposites. And finally, we prove that it is, not finally, for reality structure, I mean, that it is closed under addition. So suppose A and A prime belong to K, then what is A plus A prime? So this is going to be A, B minus B, A, plus, I'm going to use primes for the matrix A prime, so A prime, B prime, minus B prime, A prime. And when you add these, you have A plus A prime, B plus B prime. Then we have minus B prime, which I'm going to write as the opposite of B plus B prime. And finally, A plus A prime. Now you look at this matrix, the elements on the diagonal are the same. And the one in position 2, 1 is the opposite of the one in position 1, 2. Therefore, this is again an element of K. So I checked that K is closed under the additive structure. We still have a multiplicative structure. So for that, I have to check the identity matrix, which is the neutral element of 2x2 matrices for the product, 1, 0, 0, 1, is in K. And that is indeed the case because for the identity matrix, it suffices to take A equal to 1, so because we are taking A equal to 1 and B equal to 0. So the identity is in K. And we are left with the product. So suppose A and A prime are in K, then the product AA prime is AB minus BA times A prime B prime minus B prime A prime. And so when we do first row by first column, we get AA prime minus BB prime. In position 2, 1, we have minus BA prime minus AB prime. In position 1, 2, we have AB prime plus BA prime. And finally, we have minus BB prime plus AA prime. This is a product matrix, okay? Now, you look at it, and because addition in the real numbers is commutative, the elements on the diagonal are the same, and the element in position 2, 1 is the opposite of the one in position 1. So this is indeed an element of K. Okay? So what did we prove so far? We proved that K is a subring of 2 by 2 matrices over the real, with real coefficients, over the real numbers. Okay? Now, that is not exactly what we asked. We asked to prove that K is a subfield. So it's a subring which is a field. What is missing still? First of all, to be a field, you have to be commutative. And second, every non-zero element has to have an inverse, okay? Which is not true in general for 2 by 2 matrices. So we are asserting that this is true in particular for K. Okay? So to prove that K is commutative. Commutative under the product, not under addition. Every ring is commutative with respect to addition. Okay, it's the product that makes a ring commutative or not. So we need the product of AA prime, which we just computed. Okay, this is AA prime minus BA prime, then minus BA prime minus AB prime, then AB prime plus BA prime, and here we have minus BB prime plus AA prime. Okay? On the other hand, let's ask ourselves what is A prime A? A prime A. Well, you see, it's the same calculation we did above, except instead of A, we have A prime, and instead of A prime, we have A. So we are just replacing the elements with a prime with those which do not have a prime, and conversely. So this product is going to be, I'm starting on the right, so A prime B plus B prime A. And down below, we have minus B prime B plus A prime A. And on the left, we have A prime, A minus B prime B, and finally minus B prime A minus A prime B. Okay, that is the product, A prime A. And now we check, are they equal? Well, look, let's just look at the first element. You see, A prime, B, and B prime are real numbers. So in real numbers, the product is commutative. So A prime is the same as A prime A. Same for BB prime. So it's a difference of the same elements, and so they are equal. And you check all the other elements, they are all alike. So this is really important. And so the ring is commutative. Okay. Next, the thing which is missing is to be a field is that every non-zero element has inverse for the product. Okay? So the proof that if A is in A, K, and A is different from the zero element, so the neutral element of the sum, the zero matrix, then A has an inverse in K. Alright? So why is that? So suppose we have our matrix in K, which has A, B, and minus B. Okay? And suppose this is different from the zero matrix. Now the zero matrix has all the elements equal to zero. So being different from the zero matrix means that at least one of A and B, or B, are different from zero. So this implies that A is different from zero, or B is different from zero, or both. Okay. But then, if that happens, let's compute. So we want to know that A is an inverse. First of all, how do we check that a square matrix has an inverse in 2x2 matrices? We look at the determinant. So the determinant of A is the product on the main diagonal is A squared minus the product on the other diagonal, which is minus B squared. So A squared minus the opposite of B squared is A squared plus B squared. But look, since it's not the case that both A and B are equal to zero, the sum of these two squares cannot be zero, because the sum of squares is zero if and only if every square is zero. That is to say, if and only if both A and B are zero. So under the hypothesis we have above, this is different from zero. So this tells us that the matrix A is invertible as a 2x2 matrix. We still have to check that the inverse belongs to K. It's not just a generic matrix, it has to belong to K. Okay? So, what is the inverse of A? Well, there is 1 over the determinant, A squared plus B squared. And then we have an easy formula for 2x2 matrices for the inverses of 2x2. We look at the complements, right? So, the complement of A is A. In position 1, 2, I have to put the complement of the element of position 2, 1. Remember that the matrix of complements have to be transposed. And so the complement of the element in position 2, 1 is minus b. Then in position 2, 1, we have the complement of the element in position 1, 2, which is the opposite of minus b, which is b. And finally, in position 2, 2, the complement of the element of position 2, 2, which is a. Okay? Now, we can rewrite this as we wish, as a squared plus b squared minus b over a squared plus b squared, b over a squared plus b squared, and a over a squared plus b squared. Okay? So, we proved that if a is in K, it has an inverse, and we explicitly computed the inverse. What do we have to check? Does this belong to K? Well, the elements of the diagonal are the same, and the other two elements are opposite from each other. So this is in K. Okay? So at this point, we know that K is a subfield of the ring of 2x2 matrices. Okay? Notice that 2x2 matrices over the reals are not even a commutative ring, but inside that ring, it leaves a subfield, the one we've just described. Okay? So we're not quite done with this, right? And prove that the function H from the field K into the field of complex number, which assigns to the matrix A the complex number which has real and imaginary part in from the first row of the matrix, is an isomorphism of fields. Okay? So, first of all, we prove that the function H from K into the complex number defined by H of the matrix A equals A plus IB is a ring morphism. Okay? So, to be a ring morphism, in principle, it should preserve all the operations. That means zero, addition, the opposite, multiplication. Did I check the opposite before, or did I just forget? Right. Nobody said anything, right? I forgot to check that in order for it to be a subring, I'm supposed to check if it is closed under the opposite. Okay. So, let's do that before we go in. Blah, blah, blah. I know, there it is. Sorry, I'm completely... What is it doing? We don't know. This is the verification that it's closed under opposite. So I don't know what it was doing. Okay, so In principle, as I said, we should check if it preserves all the operations. Okay? But as we remarked for rings, we have a theorem. Because the rings with respect to addition form a group, in order to check that the additive structure is preserved, it suffices to check that it preserves addition. Then the multiplicative structure is another thing. So let's start with checking that it preserves addition. So we are going to compute h of a plus a prime. Okay? Now, we already computed a cube, a plus a prime, which is a matrix that we have on top, so I'm just going to copy it. H of a prime minus b b prime. Underneath we have minus b prime a minus b prime a minus, what do I have? Modulo, right? A prime b. Here we have a b prime plus a prime b, and here we have a prime minus b. Okay, that's the sum of the two matrices. Now I have to take h of that. So h is a complex number which has a real part, the element in position 1, 1, so a prime, minus b, b prime. Okay? And then we have, what am I doing? Excuse me.
Yeah,
this is the problem. So a plus a prime is written over here. Where is it? This one. Okay, so a plus a prime, b plus b prime, minus b plus b prime, a plus a prime. Okay. So, and what is h of that matrix? It's the complex number which has real part a plus a prime and imaginary part b plus b prime. Okay? But now, you remember from your calculus course that how does one add complex numbers? One add the real part and the imaginary part. So this is exactly the complex number a plus ib plus a prime plus ib prime. Okay? You add complex numbers as if they were vectors. And the two coordinates are the real part and the imaginary part. But look, this is exactly H of the matrix A, the elements A and B, let's say that's copied completely. So A, B minus B, A, plus H of A prime, B prime, minus B prime, B prime, which is H of A plus H of A prime. So we have compatibility with addition. And since with respect to addition, a ring has a group structure, this automatically implies that H is compatible with zero and with the opposite. Okay. Now for the product, we do not have a group-like structure because although K is a field, okay, it has a neutral element one, the product is commutative, okay, so we have a product. The problem is that every non-zero element has an inverse. To be a group with respect to the product, we should have that every element has an inverse. The zero matrix does not. So it does not suffice that it preserves the product to conclude that it also preserves the neutral element. So we have to check it directly. So we need to check that H of the identity matrix is the neutral element of the complex number. Now the identity matrix is 1, 0, 0, 1, and by definition, h of this is 1 plus I times 0, which is just 1. Now, 1 is the neutral element in complex numbers, so we have compatibility with multiplication. Finally, we check compatibility with the product. So this is the calculation I was doing before. A prime minus B prime. Here we have A B prime plus A prime B minus A B prime minus A prime B. And here we have A prime minus B. This is the problem. Okay. Now, what is H of this? Well, it's a complex number. It has A prime minus B prime as its real part. And AB prime plus A prime B as its imaginary part. But now, if you remember how the product of complex numbers is done, you'll think of them as being polynomials in the unknown I, subject to the relation that I square is equal to minus 1. Okay? So if you look at A plus IB times I prime plus IB prime, I claim that this product is exactly what we have in common. Because when you do the product, you have AA prime, which we have in here, and then the rest of the real part comes from the product of these two. IB times IB prime is I squared, which is minus 1, BB prime, which is what we have here. Okay? And then the imaginary part comes from two products, 1 and 2. Okay? The first one has I that multiplies AB prime. Here we go. And the second one has I multiplying A prime and B. This is exactly the product of complex numbers. But now, you look at the first complex number, this is H of the matrix A, because in the first row, it has lowercase a and lowercase b. Or let's be more explicit. AB minus BA times H of A prime B prime minus B prime A prime. And this is H of A times H. Okay? So, this proves that H is also compatible with the multiplicative structure, and therefore that it is a ring morphism. Actually, since both the domain and the codomain are fields, we just call it a morphism of fields. But a morphism of fields is nothing more than a morphism of rings. It's just a morphism of rings whose domain and codomain happen to be fields. But it's nothing more. Okay? Right, but we are not happy with the fact that it is a morphism of rings. We are claiming that it is an isomorphism. So we have to prove that it is bijective. So H is bijective. Okay, how do we prove that the function is bijective? Well, the definition was that it is has to be both injective and surjective, meaning that every element in the codomain has precisely one preimage, one element in the preimage. So, fix a complex number, fix z in C. Let's say that z is a plus ib, or let's call it x plus ay, x plus ay. And let's compute the preimages of z under h, okay? So, compute, we learn the preimages of Z along H. Okay? Okay. So, when is it that H of a matrix A is equal to, so, let's write this block. Okay? Matrix A belongs to the inverse image of Z if and only if, this is the definition, the image of A is equal to Z. Okay. Now remember that A is this type of matrix, AB minus BA, and this has to be equal to Z, which is X plus IY. Okay. Now, by definition, H of that matrix is the complex number A plus IB. And so this has to be equal to X plus IY. But now remember that two complex numbers are equal when they have the same real part and the same imaginary part. So for this to be equal, it is necessary and sufficient that A equals X and B equals Y. But then, this only happens if the matrix A is what? Well, if A has to be equal to X, then we have to have a matrix of this type. So the only preimage of Z is the matrix which has in the first row X, Y, and in the second row minus Y and X. So what did we prove? So, hence, the cardinality of a preimage of Z is 1 for every Z. And which means that H is bijective. So it's an isomorphism. Okay? So what does it mean that it is an isomorphism? It means that algebraically, the complex numbers can just be regarded as 2x2 matrices of the type we have just considered. So matrices which have the same element on the diagonal and opposite element on the other side. Okay? So you can think of these complex numbers as being embedded into the set of 2x2 matrices. It's a matrix representation of complex numbers. Okay? In fact, I'm not going to get into this, but there is a theorem that says that every ring can be realized as a ring of matrices. Okay? In particular, every field can be realized as a ring of matrices. So, that was part one. Is this clear for everybody? Is there any questions so far? What was the other question? Prove that K prime, so the elements of K having B equals 0 is a subfield which is isomorphic to the field of real numbers. Okay. Or we could do So we let K prime. So K prime is the set of matrices from K such that B is equal to 0. Okay? And you are going to prove, first of all, that it is a subfield of K. So I'm not going to do it in steps as we did before we do it directly. Okay? It is a subfield of K. Or by construction, as you see, it's a subset of K. Its elements are elements of K. So in order to prove that it is a subfield, I'm going to prove first that it is a subring, and then that in addition, it is a field. Notice that we have an advantage on the calculation we did before, because we already know that K is commutative. So when I prove that K prime is a subring of K, it will automatically be commutative. So I won't have to check again commutative, because already all the elements of K commute. Okay. So, first of all, the zero matrix, which is 0, 0, 0, 0, does belong to K. Because in order to belong to K, you have to have elements on the diagonal to be equal, which is indeed our case. And then you have to have B equal to 0. And B, which is the element in position 1, 2, is 0. Okay? The opposite, the other element is opposite, but that we already checked. Second of all, let's compute the opposite of a matrix of K, of K prime. So we need a name. Let's not use a name. Let's just write a matrix. So a matrix in K prime looks like this, A, 0, 0, A. And then because B has to be equal to 0. And I'm going to compute its opposite, okay? And the opposite is minus A, 0, 0, minus A. And sure, this is in K, right? Because we already know in K prime, sorry. We already know that it's in K. I only have to check that B is 0, okay? Addition, so suppose A and A prime belong to K prime. Let's compute the sum. So what is A plus A prime? Well, to be in K prime, this has to be of type A00A, zero, zero, A, and the other will have to be of type A prime 0, 0, A prime. And when you add them, you get A plus A prime 0, 0, A plus A prime. Okay. We already know that we are matrices in K because we are adding matrices of K prime, which is a subset of K. We only have to check that the sum is in K prime. That is, we have to check that this element is 0, and that is 0. So this is in K prime. Okay? So we are done with the additive structure. Now we take care of the multiplication. So the identity matrix, which is 1, 0, 0, 1, is in K prime because we already know it's in K and the element in position 1, 2 is 0. And finally, if we have A and A prime in K prime, then the product AA prime is A 0, 0, A times A prime 0, 0, A prime. But now, you see, when you do the product, you have, well, we could copy it from, you see, we already have the general product in here. So, you see this formula here. This was a general product in K. We just need to specialize it when D and the prime are equal to 0. You don't need to do it again, if you wish. Okay? Actually, the matrices are so simple, you can do it directly. But if you specialize B and B prime equal to 0, what happens? Well, in position 1, 1, this is going to go, so we only have A and B prime, A times A prime. And here, because both B and B prime are 0, everything goes. So we are going to go back to 0. Okay? And then because of symmetry, what we have is A, A prime, 0, 0, A, A prime. And so this is indeed in K prime because this element is commutative. So we don't have to check that it is commutative. Commutativity is for free this time because K prime is a subring of K. So the product of any two elements of K commutes. Therefore, in particular, the product of two elements of K prime commutes. Okay. We still have to check that it is that every non-zero element is invertible. Because we know that every non-zero element of K prime will have an inverse in K, but we want to check that it is rather in K prime. Okay? So suppose A is in K prime and A prime, and it belongs, what can I say? And A is different from zero. Okay? Then what is the determinant of A? First of all. Well, it's the determinant of the matrix A00A, right? Which is A squared, the real number A squared. Is that zero? No, because our assumption is that the matrix A is different from the zero matrix. It means not all the elements can be zero. But the only element that can be different from zero here is A, because if A is zero, all matrices. Now, if A is different from zero, A squared is different from zero. So A is invertible, we can compute the inverse, and we have a formula for that, right? The inverse is, let's go back, let's pretend we cannot do it, and let's copy it from here. Where is the inverse? Not here, here we go. This is the inverse, right? So, in the denominator goes A squared plus B squared. Here I forgot the B. But since in our case B is zero, the only thing that goes in the denominator is A squared, okay? So, and since B is zero, also the two elements outside the diagonal are gone. So we have A over A squared, zero, zero, A over A squared, which of course you write better as 1 over A, 0, 0, 1 over A. Okay? We do know that it is in K, we only have to check if it is in K prime. The element in position 1, 2 is 0, so this is an element of K. And so at this point, we know that K prime is a subfield of K. Okay? We are not quite done yet because it says, prove that it is isomorphic to the field of real numbers. So we have to construct, an isomorphism call it H prime from K prime into the real numbers. And how are we going to do that? Well, because we are not given a formula this time, So we take inspiration from the previous definition. The definition of H was, where is it? Here, on top, okay? When we were mapping a matrix to a complex number, we were taking A plus IB, right? Now, our matrices in K prime have B equal to zero. So I can actually use the same definition. I can set H prime of A to be lowercase a element, okay? That will be a real number, okay? So let's try that. So set H of a matrix A equal to the element A, the element in position one, okay? So we check that H is an isomorphism. How do we do that? Well, first of all, we check that it preserves the additive structure. It's called H prime, sorry, it's not called H. Okay, but H prime is an isomorphism. So, what is H prime of A plus A prime?
That's right.
Well, the sum of two matrices in K prime is written where? Here on top. Okay, A plus A prime on the diagonal and zero everywhere else. A plus A prime, zero, zero, A plus A prime. But this is just A plus A prime, the element in position one. Now, in real numbers, this is H of A, zero, zero, A, because H of that matrix is A, plus H of A prime, zero, zero, A prime, because that would be A prime. So we have compatibility with the product, and therefore, owing to the group-like structure of any ring, this is also compatible with zero and with the opposite. Okay. How about the neutral element H prime of the identity? Well, this means H prime of 1, 0, 0, 1. It's the element in position 1, 1, which is the neutral element of the product for the real numbers. And finally, we have H prime, so we check preservation of the product, right? So this is going to be A prime, 0, 0, A prime, the calculation we did before. The element in position 1, 1 is A prime. Now the A is H of A, 0, 0, A, and the A prime is H of A prime, 0, 0, A prime. So this is H of A times H. And so we also have compatibility. So at this point, we know that H prime, this is supposed to be an H. And you guys are supposed to warn me, otherwise I get suspicious that you are sleeping and looking at the board, on the screen, right? So at this point, we know that H is a ring morphism, but since both are fields, we call it a morphism of fields, okay? We have to check that it is bijective to be an isomorphism. So what do? Exactly as before, we compute the preimage of a real number x. So suppose x belongs to R, it's a real number. Then, so let's suppose x is a real number. Then, H belongs to the pre-image of X along H prime, if and only if, now this is going to be, if I write it like this, you're not going to understand. So suppose now X is in R, then A belongs to the pre-image of X along H prime. Is by definition means that H prime of A equals the real number of X. Okay. However, the matrix A since it's a matrix, H prime is defined from K prime of R, it's a matrix of this type, 0, 0, A, and H prime of such a matrix is just the element A. So, A belongs to the preimage of X if and only if its element in position 1, 1 is equal to X. But this means that the matrix A has X, 0, 0, X. So it's uniquely eternal. Okay? So this means that the preimage of every X contains exactly one element, and so that H is bijective. So it's bijective, it's a ring morphism, so it's a ring isomorphism, or rather a field isomorphism. Because of this. So, as you see, we have embedded both a field of complex numbers and a field of real numbers as subfields of the ring of two-by-two matrices. Okay, this is what this example is. Okay, are we done with this? Blah, 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 which is isomorphic, yes. Okay. Any question?
Just can we compare what we did for the addition and multiplication here?
Compare in what sense?
I think there is a
you're not satisfied with our calculation.
I just have doubt why we here we have a prime over H, but for checking after checking the addition.
Because I forgot it. We are talking about H prime. This one is the thing that bothers me. Are we talking about H prime? Yes. These are all H primes.
Okay.
Yes. We are talking about H prime. Okay. I just forgot to put the primes in many places. Yes, you are right. Okay, is that clear for everybody? Except you forget the primes. Everywhere. Here everything is H prime. They are all H primes. We are talking about H prime. I should have changed the name. Okay. So there is no H here. We are talking about the function H prime. So everything is done H prime. Yes. Okay. So thank you for that. Any other question about this? Okay. So we are good with exercise one. How are we doing time-wise? Wow. Really weird. So, let's look at ideas. An example of ideas. Okay. So, now we look at non-triangular matrices which have the same element on the diagonal. And we want to prove that that is a sub-ring of the ring of 2x2 matrices with coefficients in any field K. We don't care what K is any commutative ring, sorry. So we take 2x2 matrices with coefficients in K, and we look at these special matrices, which are upper triangular and with A on the diagonal, same element on the diagonal. Okay. We claim that this is a commutative subring of the ring of 2x2 matrices. Let's start with that. So, R is a commutative subring of 2x2 matrices with coefficients over the commutative ring K. Okay? So, usual thing. The neutral element of the sum in 2x2 matrices is the zero matrix. 0, 0, 0, and 0. Does it belong to R? Well, we need to check two things. First, that the element in position 2, 1 is 0, meaning that the matrix is upper triangular, and this element is 0. Okay, that's the first thing. That is not enough. Doesn't go. We also have to check that the elements of the diagonal are the same. And they are both zero. Okay? So therefore, this is an element in R. Let's say suppose A is equal to zero and the element in position 2, 1, which I should call 0, 2, 1, is equal to 0, to the 0 element. Okay? Then we prove closure under the opposite. So we have, suppose A is in R, then A can be written in the form A, B, 0, A. And so then the opposite of A is minus A, minus B, 0, minus A. It's upper triangular, the elements on the diagonal are like. So this belongs to R. So if A is in R, its opposite is again. Addition, suppose A and A prime belong to R. Then what do we have? Well, A plus A prime is going to be A, B, 0, A plus A prime, sorry. A prime, B prime, 0, A prime. Okay? And when you happen pointwise, you get A plus B prime, B plus B prime here, 0 plus 0, which is 0, and A plus A prime. Okay? Now you look and you see that the matrix is upper triangular, again, the element in position 2, 1 is 0. The elements on the diagonal are the same, and so this is the matrix. Okay. Then we need the identity matrix. 1, 0, 0, 1 is in R. Right. It's upper triangular, and the elements on the diagonal are the same. And finally, suppose A and A prime are in R, then A prime. A, B, 0, A, times A prime, B prime, 0, A prime. Let's do the arithmetic. We have A prime plus B, 0. In the second row, we have 0, A prime plus A, 0. First row, second column, we have A, B prime plus B, A prime. And second row, second column, we have 0 times 0 plus A, altogether, this amounts to AA prime. Here, there is not much we can do. AB prime plus BA prime. This is and this is. Okay. And now, if you look at the matrix, you will see that again, the element in position 2, 1 is 0. The elements on the diagonal are the same. So this is a matrix. Okay. Are we done? What did we have to check? Not quite. So far we proved that R is a subring of the ring of 2x2 matrices. It said a commutative subring. We cannot infer it from the commutative of 2x2 matrices because, remember, we proved in class that 2x2 matrices are non-commutative. Okay. So we have to check it directly. So let's do that. What is AA prime? Well, we have a formula for that, right? A prime and then AB prime plus BA prime. 0, AA prime. And I'm just going to rewrite this as A prime A plus, not plus, sorry. BA prime plus AB prime. So I'm using the commutativity property of the product and of the sum. 0, A prime, A. But if you check, this is A prime, B prime, 0, A prime, times A, B, 0, A. When you do the multiplication, you get A prime plus B, sorry, A prime, A plus B prime, 0, which is exactly A prime. Then you have A prime, B plus B prime, A. It's exactly what you have. Okay. So this is A prime times A. So the property is complete, and we are done. We have checked the first part. So we know at this point that K is a commutative subring of 2x2 matrices. Right. At this point, we check that the set of matrices of R which have A equal to 0 is an ideal of R. We prove that A, which is a set of matrices from R such that the element in position 1, 1 is equal to 0, is an ideal. Okay? Yes.
For talking about commutivity of the product, we don't need to know the structure of the elements.
What do you mean the structure of the elements? We know the structure of the elements. They are matrices of type AB0A.
AB0A?
They are all elements of R. We are checking C. We are checking that R, prove that the subset R is a commutative subring. So we are checking that matrices of R, commutative matrices of R, are of this type. So if you look at the calculation, when I computed A times A prime, I just copied it from here because I did it before. And that is exactly the product of two matrices of the type that sits in R.
This R does not stand for real numbers.
See it again?
The R that we have here.
No.
Is not a real
number. It's just R like ring.
R like ring.
R like ring, not R like real numbers. Usually for real numbers, I use a bold face R.
Mm-hmm.
You see, these were 2x2 matrices of a real number, so there is a bold R. Here, there is no bold R, so it's just a regular. Okay? It's just some ring of matrices. We are not playing with it. In fact, it's not isomorphic.
What? What is the nature of the element of R? Each element of R.
Oh, you cannot represent it as a real number. This is something different. See, we saw that real numbers would correspond to matrices which have A in 0 in the other position, and complex numbers would have elements A, B minus B, A. So this is none of that. We don't have a direct interpretation of it. It doesn't correspond to a numeric.
Despite of that, still we can say that it's commutative.
Yes, we check that it's commutative. It's not that we can say. We check that A times A prime is equal to A prime times A. Ah, you mean, why do we know that A prime, for example, is equal to A prime times A?
Yes.
Read the first line. Suppose K is a commutative ring. First row, so we have 2x2 matrices with coefficients in a commutative ring. Sorry, I didn't understand what your question was about. Okay, so now we check that this A is an ideal, okay? Now, being an ideal does not mean to be a subring, okay? It is a subgroup for the group structure. But the closure with respect to the multiplicative structure is completely different. So to check that it is an ideal, we have to check three things, or rather, three things we can check it. We check that it is a subgroup for the additive structure, so that the zero matrix, 0, 0, 0, 0, belongs to A. Okay? So let's just be precise, so A belongs to A if and only if it's of type 0B, 0, that's right. A is of 4, 0B, 0, 0. So these are the elements of script A, okay? Matrices which have A equal to 0. Okay. Now look at the zero matrix. Does it belong to A? Well, the condition to belong to A is that the only element which is possibly different from zero is the B in position 2. So here, all these three elements are zero, so this belongs to A. The condition is satisfied. Next, suppose A is in A, then A is of type 0b, 0, 0. Okay, what is its opposite? Well, minus a is the opposite of 0 is 0. The opposite of b is minus b. So what do we have here? All the elements are 0, except possibly the one in position 1, 2. So this b is an element of a. Okay? And it's closed under addition. So if a and a prime belong to a, then a plus a prime is going to be equal to 0, b, 0, 0, plus 0, b prime, 0, 0. And when you add them, what you get is everywhere 0, except here, you have b plus b prime. And once again, this is a matrix of A. So, up to this point, we have closure under the additive structure. Okay? But then, and you can replace this calculation, remember, by showing that A is non-empty and that it is closed under subtraction. But then, to be an ideal, you have to prove that if A is in A and A prime is in R, then both A prime and A prime A are in A. So A is, so to speak, absorbing with respect to the multiplicative problem. If you have an element of script A, which is a matrix A capital A here, and you multiply by any element of the ring, that has to end up in the subset, in our ideal A. Now, as I said, you have to check that A prime and A prime A are in A. But what do we know about the ring R? That it is commutative. So A prime is the same as A prime A, so it's enough to check that one of them is in A. We don't need to do that. Okay, so let's do the calculation. See, the matrix A is in the ideal, so it's of type 0b, 0, 0. However, A prime is just a regular matrix in R. So it's of type A prime, B prime, 0, A prime. Okay? Well, when we multiply, we find that the first row times the first column is 0, A prime, plus B, 0. The second row is 0 times A prime, plus 0 times 0. Then we have 0 b prime plus b a prime. And finally we have, sorry about that. And finally we have 0 b prime plus 0 a prime. Okay? And so this thing is equal to what? 0 a prime plus b times 0 is 0. Here the only thing that survives is b a prime. Here we have 0, and here we also have 0. And now, as you see, this belongs to A. Right? So, A is closed under multiplication by elements of the ring, and therefore it is an idea. So we check that it is an idea. Okay? We know that. This is not in the exercise, but it's a good thing to do. We know that ideals classify congruences, right? So let's ask ourselves, what is the congruence associated with this idea? Meaning, when is it that two matrices of R are congruent for the congruence induced by this idea? Okay, so let's remember, we have that A is congruent to A prime. I don't know if I use this symbol, it doesn't matter. If and only if A minus A prime belongs to the ideal A. That was the definition, right? So this means that, so the matrix A is going to be A, B, 0, A. A prime is going to be A prime, B prime, 0, A prime. This has to belong to A. And when we do this, we find A minus A prime, B minus B prime, 0 minus 0 is 0, and here we have A minus A prime, has to belong to A. Now, what is the condition to belong to A? It's that the only element which is possibly different from zero is in position 1, 2. So then it means that A minus A prime has to be equal to zero. That's the only condition we have. So if and only if A minus A prime is equal to zero, which means A is equal to A prime. So two matrices of pi are congruent in the congruence induced by this idea when they have the same element in position 1, 1. So when A is equal to A prime. Okay? We don't check, we don't have to check it because it's congruent. We know it from the theory. Because script A is an idea that this is going to be an equivalence relation which is compatible with all the operations. Right? As I said, this was just an aside, it was not part of the exercise, but it helps us to understand. Okay, blah, blah, blah. Prove that it is an idea, and prove that the function h from r into k defined by the formula which takes the matrix A into the top left element induces a ring isomorphism from r mod A into k. All right, so what is the situation here? Then this is going to be free, let's say, free. So, this is what we have. We have R, we have K, and we have a purported homomorphism of rings H. Okay, we have to check it because there is homomorphism, because that is not given, okay? So we have to check. So H sends the matrix A into, so H of the matrix A is the top left element, and we want to check that this thing induces an isomorphism from R mod A. What is R mod A? Well, remember, it's the set of equivalence classes of elements of R, so equivalence classes of matrices, under the congruence generated by the idea A. So here we have, because we need this calculation, we have a slightly better understanding. What is the equivalence class of the matrix A? So the equivalence class of the matrix A, which will contain all matrices of type A, 0A, and here it can have whatever we want. Or let's give it a name. This is not good. Let's call it Y, such that Y belongs to K. So the elements on the diagonal have to be the same as A, as we just said. You see, A has to be equal to A prime. But the other element can be whatever. So that is the equivalence class of a matrix A. So the elements in here, in the quotient set, are these equivalence classes. Because we have a congruence, because A is an ideal, we know that this quotient is not just a quotient set, we know that it is a ring. Okay, and let me remind you, just for the sake of remembering what we did, that the operations here are defined as follows. The class of A plus the class of A prime is the class of A plus A prime. And similarly, the class of A times the class of A prime is the class of A prime. The neutral element is the class of the identity for the product, and the neutral element for the sum is the class of the matrix zero, and so forth. I just wrote this, just wrote down these two, just to remind you what is the situation. Okay. So, what does it mean that H induces an isomorphism between R mod A and K? Well, remember that from the first isomorphism theorem, we have a projection here. And from the general theory, we know that if H is a morphism of rings, meaning a morphism of T-models, then the projection is also a morphism of T-models, and that there is a morphism here, called G, okay? So once we check that H is a ring morphism, we will automatically have a ring morphism G from R mod A in K. And then we will check whether that is an isomorphism, because this is what is being asked. Check that H induces a ring isomorphism. Induces means that the one that one gets from the isomorphism here. Okay? All right, so let's get to work. First of all, we prove that H is the ring morph. Okay, how do we do that? Remember, we only have to check three things: that it preserves this sum, because then it will automatically preserve zero and the opposite. But then for the product, we will have to check everything. It will have to preserve one and the product. So, what is h of a plus a prime? Well, we already computed a plus a prime. This was a plus a prime here, b plus b prime here, zero, a plus a prime. And h of a matrix is the element in position 1, 1. So it's a plus a prime. But lowercase a is the image under h of this matrix, which is a. And a prime is h of a prime, b prime, c prime. So this is h of a plus h of a prime. And so we have compatibility with addition. Then we check compatibility with the neutral element. What is h of the identity? Well, the identity is the matrix which has one of the diagonal and zero of the s. And h assigns to it the top left element, which is equal to 1. So h of the neutral element of R is the neutral element in K. So h is compatible with that. And finally, h of a prime. So I forgot, what was the formula for the product? Blah, blah, blah. A prime. A prime, A B prime plus A prime B, zero, A B. Okay, this is what we have. Right? Or what is this matrix? So what is H of this matrix? A prime. And what is A? It's H of A B zero A. And A prime is H of A prime B prime zero A prime. So this is H of a matrix A times H of a matrix H prime. And we have compatibility with it. Okay? So at this point we know that H is a group morphism, a ring morphism, right? So, and therefore it induces a morphism of rings G. Remember that G was defined by this formula. G of the class of the matrix A is H of the matrix A. That is the element in position 1, 1. And as you see, it does not depend on the element I choose in the class. Because all the elements in the class, look at here, they all have little a in position 1, 1. The one that can change is the Y. But in position 1, 1, they have all the same elements, okay? So this is just a double check that this is going to win. Okay, so we know for free, so from the first isomorphism theorem, first isomorphism theorem, we know H induces the morphism of rings, of course, G from R mod A into K. Our question is, why is this an isomorphism? Okay. So, to check that a morphism of rings is an isomorphism, we have to check what? That it is both surjective and injective. But we already know from the isomorphism, from the first isomorphism theorem, that G is not just any ring morphism. It's automatically injective. In the first isomorphism theorem, we know that the factorization that we get over here has P surjective and G injective. That comes from the theory. So it's not just a morphism, but problem here. Monomorphism. Monomorphism. So it's already injective. So we only have to prove that G is also surjective, and then it will be objective. So we need to prove, we only need to prove. We only need
to prove
that G, what's the name? Yes, it's G. G is subjective. Well, you see, we are not quite done with the first isomorphism theorem, because the first isomorphism theorem tells us that whenever you have H, that has a unique factorization, P times G, where G is injective, but there is another feature of G. And the other feature is that the image of G is equal to the image of H. Okay? So, again, by the first isomorphism theorem, you go to see the right, okay? So first isomorphism theorem, yes.
Excuse me, I cannot read the end of first line.
We only need to prove that G is surjective.
No, the first line. We know that H, what? The first.
We know that H induces a monomorphism.
Induces. Okay.
Induces, yes. Yes, we have it. So, by the first isomorphism theorem, we know that the image of G is equal to the image of H. Okay? Meaning, an element in K comes from something under G, if and only if it comes from something under H. Okay? So you pick an element here, call it little a. We know that this little a is H of some matrix in R, if and only if it's A, if and only if it's G of the equivalence class of the matrix. They are the same image. Remember, the image is the set of all elements of type H of A, or G of the class of A, depending on what is the domain of the morphism. So, to say that G is surjective means that every element of K is in the image. It's the image of something. Okay? So, G is surjective if and only if the image of G is the pole of K. But the image of G is the same as the image of H by the theorem. Okay? And saying that the image of H is K means every element of K comes from some element of R to H. So this is like saying that H is surjective. Okay? So by the first isomorphism theorem, in order to prove that G is an isomorphism, I only need to prove that H is surjective. And so this is the thing we're going to prove. Okay, so we prove. So we prove that H is surjective. So let's pick an element in K. So pick A in K, or call it X. X in K. And let's check whether it has a preimage. Being surjective means that it has a preimage. Okay. So a matrix A belongs to the preimage of X. What's the name of morphism? H star of X. If and only if H of A is equal to X. But H of A means H of a matrix A, B, 0, A is equal to X, which is like saying that A is equal to X, because H of a matrix is the element in position 1, 1. And so, what does this say about A? Well, it has to have an X here. This has to be 0, this has to be equal to that. But here, we can have, okay, let's not put here this an asterisk, otherwise you think it's an X. Okay? This can be where B is an image. So how many images, how many brain images do we have? As many as we want. Well, it depends on how many elements are in K. Okay? So at least we have a brain image. Pick the matrix which has axis on the diagonal. And if you have no idea, you can pick B equal to 0. So 0 and 0 are the other two elements. H of that matrix is going to be A. So H is surjective. Okay? So we are done. G is an isomorphism. Okay? So now you start to understand how useful is the first isomorphism theorem, because checking directly that G is an isomorphism would be much harder, because G works with equivalence classes, so it's not that straightforward. Okay. Good. Is everything clear? Is there any questions so far? Yes. Yeah, see, saying that H is surjective means that whenever you pick an element X in K, you find a matrix A such that H of A is equal to X. So for example, if I take H of X, 0, 0, X, I can take any B, but for example, B equals 0, this is going to be X. So we have a brain image for this. Okay, let's move on. What is this? Ah, this is harder. Alright, so suppose R is a commutative ring. We look at 3 by 3 matrices of this type. So we have an A in the top left corner, two B's on the other two elements in the diagonal, and a C in position 3. So we want to check that this is a commutative subring of 2 by 2 matrices. And we want to prove that this is not what I want. It's an idea, and that the quotient is isomorphic to the product ring. Ah, because what you wanted to do is the next one. Let's do the next one first. So this one is pretty much similar to the one we just did. Okay? Just a different type of matrix rings. The only thing you don't know, maybe we will do that. Is that if you take any commutative ring, R, let's do this part at least, okay? Let's prove that R times R, so suppose R is a commutative ring, then this is a commutative ring with the following operations, okay? So the zero is the pair which has both elements equal to zero, the zero of R. Okay. The opposite of what did I use? I don't know. Let's say of x1. So suppose x has coordinates x1, x2. Yes.
So we're solving when 420.
No.
421.
No, we are just doing this thing. So I'm just showing you, because this is a useful thing to know, that if you take any commutative ring, we prove, so variation, prove that if R is a commutative ring, then R times R is a commutative ring with operations. So the zero element is the pair which has zeros in both coordinates. Okay? If x is equal to x1, x2, or let's write it like this, which is this. The opposite of x1, x2 is the pair which has the opposite coordinates. Okay? The sum x1, x2 plus y1, y2 is x1 plus y1, x2 plus y2. And lastly, the neutral element is the pair 1, 1, where 1 is the neutral element of a product in R. And finally, the product x1, x2 times y1, y2 is again point wise, xy, x1, y1, x2, y1. So we are proving that this is a commutative ring. Okay? So I'm not going to do all the calculations. I'm going to check just a few because it's more a tedious type of calculation. Okay? Let's check, for example, that let's check that 0 is a neutral element to start with. Okay, so 0 is neutral. Okay, let's do commutativity of addition first, so that we save a little bit of time with neutral element to that box. Okay, so we prove that the sum is commutative. So, suppose that you have x plus y, okay? This means x1, x2, plus y1, y2. So I'm using x to develop the couple. Okay. How is addition defined? Well, this is going to be, this is a plus sum. This is equal to x1 plus y1, x2 plus y. Okay, this is how sum is defined. But notice that x1 plus y1, this is a sum that we do in R, and R is commutative. So, a commutative ring, so we don't need a commutative ring. So, this is y1 plus x1, y2 plus x2. And this is, I'm continuing down the y1, y2 plus x1. Which is y plus x. So addition is commutative. Okay? I'm only going to check, let's only check that the product is also commutative and then I leave the rest. Okay? So the product is commutative. So suppose you want to do xy. Okay? This is x1 times y1, y2, which is defined as x1, y1, x2, y2. But since now R is a commutative ring, the product of elements in each coordinate is the product of elements from R. So this is just y1, x1, y2, x2, which is equal to y1, y2 times x1, x2. Because when you do the product, you do it coordinate wise. This is y times x. Okay? So this is an important thing to know because it happens quite often. So whenever you take a commutative ring R, if you take its Cartesian product with itself and you put pointwise operations, that turns out to be a commutative. So, but as I said, we are not doing this. I just mentioned that because it pops up again here. It pops up where? It doesn't pop up. No. But that is was something useful. Okay, so we have 3x3 matrices of this sort. Let's start to prove that K, so the set of matrices, is a commutative subrange of 3x3 matrices. Then we prove that A and B are ideas. We prove that B is contained in A, and we prove that there is a morphism of quotient rings from K mod B into K mod A defined by that quotient. Okay? So, start with the initial part. The initial part is what? Prove that it is a commutative subring. Okay, so, what do we want to do? Let's try to abbreviate a little bit the proof. First of all, K is non-empty because, let's do this. So, K is a commutative subring of 2x2 matrices, of 3x2 matrices, of nothing. So I'm going to use the shorter version of the criteria, okay? So, first of all, K is non-empty. Because, for example, the zero matrix belongs to K. Is it true that the zero matrix has that type? Yes, it's upper triangular. The elements on the diagonal are all alike. The elements on the upper sub-diagonal are all alike, and so forth. You see, the structure of a matrix is like this. It has equal elements on successive diagonals, okay? And below the main diagonal, everything is zero. And the zero matrix, for sure, is not proper. Okay, it's much better than that. Everything is equal, so it's not empty. Second, I'm going to prove that the difference of two matrices in K is in K. So, suppose I take A, B, C, 0, A, B, 0, 0, A, minus A prime, B prime, C prime, 0, A prime, prime, 0, 0, B prime. So these are two matrices in K. I'm going to prove that their difference is in K. But how is the difference done? Well, it's done adding to the first the opposite of the second. Both the opposite and the addition and sum are done coordinate wise. So what we have here is A minus. Oh, so. A minus A. A minus A prime. B minus B prime, C minus C prime. 0 minus 0 is 0. Here we have A minus A prime, B minus B prime, 0 minus 0 again, and A minus A prime. And this indeed is a matrix of A. Because you see the elements are equal on successive diagonals. Okay? The identity matrix 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0 is in K. Okay? All the elements on successive diagonals are equal, and it's upper triangular. And finally, if I multiply two matrices, A, B, C, 0, A prime, 0, A, B, 0, 0, A. A prime, B prime, C prime, 0, A prime, B prime, 0, 0, A prime. All right, so let's do the product. First row by first column, we only pick an A, A prime. Let's do first row, second column, we get A, B prime plus B, A prime. And then we have plus C times 0, so there's nothing. First row, fourth column, this is a different story. You get AC prime plus BB prime plus CA prime. Okay? Right. Second row, by first column, we have 0, 0, and 0. So this is 0. Then we have 0B prime plus AA prime plus B times 0. So it's just AA. Second row, third column. We have 0C prime, AB prime, plus BA prime. And finally, third row, we get 0, 0, AA prime. And now, if you check, this matrix is upper triangular, and the elements on the diagonal, the elements on each diagonal above the main diagonal are all equal. So this is a matrix which sits in K, right? Okay, so at this point we know that this is a subring. We haven't checked that it is commutative, but you see that if you exchange the matrix with the primes and not non-prime elements, let's remove this stuff so it's more visible, okay? What happens when you do A times A prime? Or let's say A prime times A. If you exchange the primes with the non-primes, you get A prime A. Here you get A prime B plus B prime A. Here you get A prime A. Here you get A prime C plus B prime B plus C prime A. And here you have what? A prime B plus B prime A prime A. Now you look at this matrix and you look at the one above, and they are exactly the same. Okay? It's just that some elements are permuted. But the elements in R, because R is a commutative ring, in R, addition and multiplication are commutative. So this is exactly equal to A, A prime. And so indeed we have a commutative sum. Okay, let's look at the two ideas. Okay? So first of all, we prove that A, which is the matrices of what is the name? Such that B equal A is equal to 0 is an ID. Okay? So how do we check that? Well, again, we can use the abbreviated form with the calculation we already did. So first of all, to prove that it is not empty, I'm going to use the neutral element. Okay? 0 belongs to A. The zero matrix has, so let's just write on the side what type of matrix is this, okay? Just to make it clear. So A is a matrix which has zero on the diagonal, and we have B, B, and C. Below the diagonal, everything is zero. So these are the elements of A, of this purported idea of A. Okay. So first of all, the zero matrix belongs to A, so A is non-empty. A is empty. All right. Then I check that it is closed under differences. But this, you see, just look at this. To be in A means that A and A prime are zero, right? If I want two matrices of script A. And if A and A prime are zero in the difference, what do I get on the diagonal? Zero minus zero, so everything is zero. Okay, let's write it down. I see the figure is prime. This is going to be zero, zero, zero. I'm not writing elements underneath the diagonal because we know they are all zeros. Okay, so I'm omitting them. You don't do that in exam. You write them. B, C, and B. Minus. 0, 0, 0, B prime, C prime, B prime. Okay? And when you do the difference, you find 0, B minus B prime, C minus C prime, 0, B minus B prime, and 0. So the elements on the diagonal are all 0. And so this belongs to A. And so far, so good. What is left? To check that A is closed under a product by any element of K. So, suppose I have A in the ideal A and A prime in K, then I'm going to prove that A times A prime is in the ideal. Now, this is 0, B, C, 0, 0, B, 0, 0, 0 times A prime, B prime, C prime, 0, A prime, B prime, 0, 0, A prime. So I'm going to prove that this is Mr. Okay? Notice that I only need to check on one side because we know that the ring is commutative. Okay? So I don't need to do that. Okay. And here is where miracle happens, because when we multiply the first row by the columns, by the first column, we have 0 A prime plus B times 0 plus C times 0. So it's a 0. When we do the second row by the first column, we have 0 A prime plus 0 times 0 plus B times 0. It's a 0. The third row, listen, the third row is all zeros. So I'm not even going to spend time on it, right? Okay, let's finish with the first row. First row by second column, I have 0 B prime, BA prime, and then there is plus C times 0, so there is only BA prime. How about second row, second column? That's good because we have 0B prime plus 0A prime plus B times 0. And you see, at this point, I wouldn't need any extra calculation. Ah, no, we have to check if they are equal on the other. So, first row, third column, I have 0C prime, okay? Then I have BC prime, and then I have plus CA prime.
BB
plus CA prime. Second row, third column, I have 0C prime plus 0B prime plus BA prime. And now we are done. Okay? You see that this is a matrix in, or we already know that it's a matrix in K, and the elements on the diagonal are also, so this belongs to the idea.
Yes.
In the first row, the third one, I think it is BB prime, not BC prime.
You mean this element?
Yes.
Okay,
right? I don't know.
So it's first row, first column. So we have 0 times C prime plus BB prime plus CA prime. Okay. So at this point, we know that A is an idea. Okay? All right. So I'm not going to check it, but B is also an idea by the same sort of calculation. Okay? Let's just make clear what is B. So B is supposed to be a script B, I don't know. Okay. It's supposed to be a Gothic B, whatever it is. These are the matrices in R, such that A equals B equals 0. So the matrices in B are of type 0, 0, 0, because A is 0. Again, a 0, 0, because B is 0. So they only have a C up here. Okay? So these are matrices of type, which the type which sits in the idea. Okay. You do the same type of calculations and you check that it is an idea. I think we did that enough times. Okay, that's not the interesting part of the exercise. Okay. Prove that B is contained in A. Or B is contained in A, it's clear. Because if a matrix A belongs to the ideal B, have to find a way of writing this book. I don't have a way of writing this book. So you understand that it is the idea. It means that both A and B are equal to 0. Okay, that's the definition. But if both A and B are equal to 0, in particular, A is equal to 0. And if A is equal to 0, look at the definition. Then A is in A. Belongs to the ideal script A. So all the matrix of the ideal script B, maybe we pretend we do something like this. Okay? All the matrices of script B belong to script A, which means, hence, script B is contained in script A. Okay? Which is what is asked. B is contained. Now prove that the function. So we have a function h from, so because they are ideals, we know that the quotient R mod A is a commutative, is a ring, okay? So from the one on the side. We know that this is a commutative ring. We know that R mod A is also a commutative ring, and we are claiming that the function h that sends the equivalence class of a matrix according to the ideal B, which I'm going to write this way. So this is the equivalence class under B, to the equivalence class of A under the ideal A, that this is a ring morphism. Okay. Now this is pretty delicate because, first of all, I have to check that the definition is well posed, because you see, suppose the class of A is equal to the class of A prime. That is to say, suppose I pick two different representatives of the same equivalence class. Okay? So both A and A prime are equivalent under B. So according to my definition, they should give the same equivalence class under A. So I have to check if they give the same equivalence class under A. Meaning, see, I have an equivalence class of the matrix A under the congruence induced by B. I have to pick a representative and take the equivalence class under the congruence generated by A. But I chose a representative. Suppose I choose A, the capital A, and suppose some of you chooses A prime. They are both elements in the same equivalence class. Do we have a guarantee that we end up with the same result under H? Okay? Because it's not clear. We have our equivalence class, there are many elements into it. I picked one and I computed H using that particular element. You picked another and you computed H using the other element. Okay, I have to guarantee that at the end of calculation we get the same result. Okay. So how see how this is done. If the equivalence class of B is the same, sorry, the equivalence class of A is the same as the equivalence class of A prime under B, what was the definition of a, so this means that A is congruent to A prime under the congruence induced by the ideal B. Okay? That's the definition, being in the same equivalence class. Means they are equivalent under the relation. Okay? However, how is the equivalence, how is the congruence defined by B? How is it defined? Well, we saw it before. They are congruent if the difference belongs to the ideal B. However, we just proved that the ideal B is contained in A. So this means that the difference A minus A prime belongs to A. And if the difference belongs to A, this means that A is equivalent to A prime under the congruence induced by A. And if they are equivalent in an equivalence, it means that their equivalence classes are the same. So the class of A is the same as the class of A prime for the equivalence induced by A. Okay? So it doesn't matter which representative I pick for the same class. Whether it's A or A prime, I end up with the same result. Okay, this is what H of equivalence class of this element is. It's this thing here. Okay, look at the definition on top. So H is well defined. It does not depend on how I pick a representative of equivalence class. Okay? Now we have to check that it preserves sum, product, and the neutral element of the product. Okay? Let's do it for the sum, then for the product it's the same. Okay. So this is a little bit tricky. It's different from the calculation we did before, the calculations we did before, because we are working with equivalence class. So I want to prove that H of, let's say, the equivalence class of A under B plus the equivalence class of A prime under B is H of the equivalence class of A under B plus H of the equivalence class of A prime under B. Okay, this is what preservation of sum means. Okay? And you will notice that this is exactly, let's do it one. So let's make this remark. Observe that. Suppose the equivalence class of A plus the equivalence class of A prime mod B is equal to the equivalence class of some element A double prime under B. Okay? Well, the sum of the two equivalence classes has to be some equivalence class because the quotient ring is a ring. The operation of addition is internal. So the sum of two classes will be an equivalence class. Okay? All right. What does this mean? Well, How do you do the equivalence classes, the sum of it, of two equivalence classes? Well, this is the equivalence class of A plus A prime under B, the one on the left. And this is the equivalence class of A double prime under B. But we just saw that saying that two equivalence classes are the same, look on top, means that they are different, the difference of the representatives is in B. So this means that A plus, what did they do? A plus A prime minus A double prime belongs to the ideal B. But B is contained in A. So this implies it's not equivalent, that A plus A prime minus A double prime belongs to the ideal A, which is equivalent to saying that the equivalence class of A plus A prime under A is equal to the equivalence class of A double prime under A, which again, it's equivalent to say that the equivalence class of A under A plus the equivalence class of A prime under A is equal to the equivalence class of A double prime under A. Okay? What does this lengthy calculation tell us? It tells that if the sum of the two equivalence classes of A and A prime under B is the class of A double prime, then it's only an implication. The sum of the two equivalence classes of A and A prime under A is the class of A double prime under A. Okay? So we are set. Let's compute. Look at the calculation we have to do on top. What is H of the class of A under B plus the class of A prime under B? Or the class of A plus the class of A prime is the class of A double prime under B. So this is H of the class of A double prime under B. Right? But what does H do? H takes the class of something under B and maps it to the class of the same matrix under A. So this is H to the equivalence class of A double prime under A. It's just this, right? H of the class of A under B is the class of A under A. But now let's look at the second cloud we have here. The class of A double prime under A is the class of A under A plus the class of A prime under A. Okay? And what is the class of A under A? This is H of the class of A under B, because this was how H was defined, plus the class of A prime under A is H of the class of A prime under B. Right? Now look at the first, look at the last, and this is exactly preservation of the sum. Okay? So this is definitely harder to check, because we are working with equivalence classes, and so you have to be careful. You have to know what the result is. So first of all, you have to check independence of the representative. And then you have to use your knowledge of the equivalence classes to see how it's done. I'm not going to do the product, because it's going to be the same thing. And anyway, it's solved in the exercise. This is what? Number 420. Okay. So it's solved there. And all right. So this is, I wanted to do something on polynomials, but I guess this is already, we are already almost half an hour past, not really half an hour, 20 minutes past. Okay. I don't know, if you can bear a little bit more, we can do another one. If you are tired, we can stop here.
If we need on track and then we can go forward.
You need what?
On track.
A
break.
A break. Ah, okay, let's do a very short break, okay? A couple of minutes, then we do the last exercise. So I want to see something on polynomials, just not 12 minutes.
Save it.
Okay, a couple of breaks.